This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Welcome to worship. I am Song Yu, pastor here at Sudley Church. I'm so glad you are here with us in spirit and prayer. We are already in September. Wow, time flies. Hope that you're having a good day today. Starting today, we dive into the essential beliefs of our Christian faith by exploring the Apostles' Creed. Today, so we're going to have an introductory time to explore what is the Apostles' Creed and how relevant it is to us here and now. All right, shall we prepare our hearts for a holy encounter with the Lord? Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, Jehovah, we come before you with gratitude and humility and joy in our hearts. We are privileged to enter the Holy of Holies in your heavenly throne by the precious blood of Jesus Christ. We give thanks to you for inviting us back to this holy hour of worship. Will you help us to open our hearts to you so that we may get refreshed, recharged by the movement of the Holy Spirit in our midst as we encounter you, our living God, all for your glory, for your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. I'd like to show you something today. Do any of you guys know what this is? That's right, it's a potato. I love potatoes. Potatoes taste good. They're full of vitamins and minerals that help us stay healthy, and there are many different ways we can cook potatoes. One of the ways I eat potato is I bake it. I love baked potatoes. I bake it at 425 degrees for an hour, split it open, and top it with butter and sour cream. Oh, yeah. You know, I could have used some sour cream on those tacos last Sunday, but that's a different matter. So, in fact, I'm just kidding, guys. In fact, it sounds so good that I think I'll take this potato and make it for supper. All right. I'm going to show you something else. See if you guys can guess what this is. You guys are good. It's a potato. You know, I love potatoes. They taste good. They're full of vitamins and minerals that help us stay healthy. And there are many different ways we can cook them. One of my other favorite ways to eat a potato is to mash it. I peel the potato, boil it in water for 20 minutes, drain off the water, add a little milk, a little butter, a little sour cream. Oh yeah. And then mash potatoes with my hand mixer. Sometimes I eat mashed potatoes just plain, and sometimes I eat them with, I've tried them with cheese on them. There's all sorts of ways you can do it. Usually I cut up my meat and dip each bite in the mashed potatoes. I also like putting corn on mashed potatoes. You know, mashed potatoes are so good. In fact, that thing sounds so good, I think I might just make mashed potatoes for supper tomorrow. All right, I'm gonna show you guys something else. Are you guys ready? Does anyone know what this is? That's right, it's a potato. Don't sound so excited about it. You know, I love potatoes. They taste good, they're full of vitamins and minerals, and they help us stay healthy, and there are many different ways we can cook them. Another way I like to eat potatoes is to make hash browns. Now, hash browns aren't quite as good for me as baked potatoes and mashed potatoes. Hash browns have to be fried in grease or vegetable oil, which adds a little fat to them, but I still like to eat them. In fact, hash browns sound so good that I think I might make hash browns for supper the day after tomorrow. All right. So, we have three potatoes, right? Do you know what the amount of food you eat at one time is called? It's called a serving. Probably that name from the fact that when someone gives you food, they serve you. But there's another way we could think of it. Remember the vitamins and minerals that I kept mentioning? Well, we could think of the potato as serving whoever eats it. It serves you or me by giving us the nutrition that we need. The potato is serving me when I eat it for supper. How are people like potatoes? Go ahead, give me an answer. How are people like potatoes? Well, all of those are good ideas, but there's another way. Remember the potato? It serves me by giving me nutrition. But it can do that in many different ways. I could bake it, mash it, fry it, and I could cook the potato in other ways too. There are many different ways the potato can serve me. Potatoes serve people, and people serve God. But guess what? There are many different ways that we can serve God. Who has some ideas? I bet you all have some really good ideas. You've thought of a lot of ways we can serve God. Those ways are all different, but they're all important, and they're all ultimately serving God, right? All right, so Paul, who wrote much of the New Testament, gives us some ideas too. In Ephesians 4:11, he wrote, "The gifts he gave were that some would be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors, and some teachers." These are just some of the ways that Paul says we can serve God. They're all different, and they're all ultimately serving God, right? Now, how are people different than potatoes? Go ahead, answer. Very good. Those are all ways we are different than potatoes. But there's another very important way. Remember the potato? It can only serve one person one way and only one time. After I eat this potato, it'll be gone. I could never eat it again. But people aren't like that. Each one of us can serve God many times in many different ways. In fact, God will probably ask you to serve him different ways at different times in your life. The important thing to remember is Everyone is able to serve God, so never think that you can't. Also, God is never done with you. God is always able to use you, even when you think you don't have any abilities. Even if someday you think you're too old or too tired, even if you think you've sinned so badly that God won't ever want to hear from you ever again, He still loves you, and He's still going to use you if you let Him. So always be alert for ways that you can serve God, and always be listening for God's directions. Then you can serve God too, like a potato. Let's pray about that. Dear Lord, thank you for this beautiful day. Thank you for making potatoes that give us some of the nutrition we need. Please help us to remember that we can serve you in many different ways, and help us to see how you want each of us as individuals to serve. Thank you for guiding us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
It's time to share our praises and prayers with each other. We praise the Lord for this holy opportunity to worship God together and for His continued protection over our church family and friends. Here are our continued prayer needs. We pray for our sister Joyce Kennison recovering from COVID. We pray for Jason Peach, son of Sally Ree's friend. He's at home recovering from cardiac arrest. We pray for Brad Benton for his continued solid recovery from back surgery. We pray for our brother Paul O'Meara recovering from his recent knee surgery. We pray for Nancy Pauling recovering from cornea transplant surgery. We pray for God's almighty healing touch upon each one of them in Jesus' name, so that they may get better and better each day. Let us bring our prayers, our requests to the Lord in prayer. Lord, you are Jehovah Rapha, the Lord who heals. We come before you with prayer requests and concerns. You know what we need even before we ask. Will you stretch out your mighty healing hands to each one of them as we pray for them in our hearts? Allow your sons and daughters to experience your healing touch so that they may get better and well under your protection, healing presence, your guidance in their lives. We know that you will send your angels, your people to their side. Enable them to stand up with faith and assurance of your presence in their journey, experiencing the recovery, restoration, the wholeness of their life. Bless your sons and daughters. Thank you, Lord, for giving us this time to pray to you. In the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Today's scripture reading comes from Ephesians 4:11 through 16. The gifts he gave were that some would be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers, to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ, until all of us come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to maturity, to the measure of full stature of Christ. We must no longer be children, tossed to and fro and blown about by every wind of doctrine, by people's trickery, by their craftiness in deceitful scheming. But speaking the truth in love, we must grow up in every way into Him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body joined and knit together by every ligament with which it is equipped, as each part is working properly, promotes the body's growth in building itself up in love. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. It's time for offering prayer. A United Methodist men will have their yard sale this Saturday from 7 a.m. to 1 p.m., rain or shine. There are 24 spaces available, and you can contact our brother John if you have any question. A United Methodist Women is asking for help to build our 100th turkey oyster dinner. Please help us fill our pantry. We need donations of canned goods for this dinner on Saturday, October 22nd. See the display in the fellowship hall when you come to church for specific items to donate. Yeah, we need to stick to these brands so that our meal is consistently delicious. We pray for God's blessings upon these holy endeavors to advance the kingdom of God. And this past Monday, we gathered together in the church, packed 10,000 meals to feed the hungry all around the world through the Rise Against Hunger organization. Over 60 people came out and provided helping hands and participate in this very powerful, meaningful, joyful mission project together. Thank you so much for all your support through your prayers, your generous giving, and your caring hearts and praying hands for God's kingdom. Special thanks go to our sister Loretta for coordinating this special mission opportunity. And her husband Jeff worked really hard. Thank you so much. Shall we take a moment to give thanks to the Lord? Lord, you're the ultimate owner of everything, including our lives. You're the ultimate author of our life journey. We come before you with gratitude, remembering who you are and what you have done in our lives. Thank you, Lord, for your presence, your love, your providence, your presence in our journey. We count our blessings. Lord, help us to continue to discern your will, your plan, your purpose for our lives, so that we may bring glory and honor to you through our journey and experience and enjoy a profound sense of fulfillment and the meaningfulness that comes from our journey with you. Bless every hand that prepared the offering for your glory, for your kingdom. Wherever this offering is used, your glory will be manifest. People will experience and celebrate the love of Jesus Christ in multiple tangible ways. Continue to equip us with the powerful instruments of your righteousness, your love and peace, your shalom, so that we may bring your peace, your kingdom to this world, in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Shall we profess our faith by saying the Apostles' Creed together? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. What is the Apostles' Creed? It is the Church's foundational statement of faith. Christians, regardless of all different denominations, all share the Apostles' Creed as the universal or ecumenical statement of faith. An apostle means a disciple of Jesus Christ. The English word creed comes from the Latin word credo, which means I believe. So for disciples of Jesus who sincerely desire to follow Jesus Christ, this statement captures and summarizes the essential beliefs of Christianity. So Apostles' Creed is like a code of conduct that every Christian is expected to accept and live by. Interestingly, Apostles' Creed starts with, I believe, not I think, therefore I am, or I observe, or I guess. This indicates that our faith starts with the revelation of God. God reveals who he is and what his will is to us. that requires a leap of faith on our part to accept and believe it. Christian faith is not merely based on cognitive reasoning or empirical observation. What is strange, even paradoxical, about Christian faith is that we believe to understand what we are talking about. Not the other way around. We feel like we need to first understand what we are dealing with so that at least we can choose and we can decide whether we will believe it or not. It makes all the sense. It sounds reasonable and rational. It works for all other areas in our life, but it does not quite work well for our faith in God. We are called to believe in God first in order to understand or deepen our understanding of who God is. Without taking a step of faith, we wouldn't or couldn't understand what we're really talking about. There is a reason why many philosophers or scientists often end up becoming atheists, who deny the existence of God, or agnostics, who claim for sure that they do not know for sure. Why? Because their starting point is wrong. Again, our Christian faith starts with the revelation of God that requires a leap of faith. This is why our Christian faith requires humility before God. When we approach God, we are to humble ourselves. Curiously, the Apostles' Creed ends with Amen. Do you know what that implies? It means that the Apostles' Creed is a form of prayer in humility before God. It's a prayerful declaration of what we believe before God. It's a prayerful commitment to God. By reciting the Apostles' Creed, we declare who we are in light of who God is and what we believe in prayer. So like the Lord's Prayer, which is a very powerful universal prayer for Christians, Apostles' Creed can be a powerful spiritual weapon we can utilize as we face our giants in spiritual battles. You may wonder why we deal with this now. Because it is important to revisit and reclarify what we say we believe, especially as we, the United Methodists, have been facing our denominational crisis and confusion and anxiety. We are no longer united but divided Methodists, especially over the contentious issue of human sexuality. Christian messages or Christian truth claims in general have been watered down, compromised, or secularized for whatever reason. It is reported that false prophets in the end time are on the rise, as warned by our Lord Jesus Christ. So it's awfully easy to get lost and confused or even overwhelmed amid all this, not to mention it's been increasingly difficult to discern or tell which news media is trustworthy or unbiased. We are bombarded with and deafened by so many competing noises out there. So as we try to navigate this challenging terrain and find what is true, is it critical to go back to the core of who we are and what we are called to do in the first place? Otherwise, we would get lost and compromise our missions and ministries for no good reason and make ourselves a laughingstock before a watching world. As long as we anchor ourselves in solid biblical, theological beliefs, we can go through this challenging time. Of course, counting on the power and protection of the Holy Spirit who dwells in us, moves through us. How was the Apostles' Creed formed? According to church historians, Apostles' Creed was developed from a series of questions asked of the candidate for baptism as an affirmation of faith. This foundational statement of faith derives from early church's baptismal preparation. even when there is no universal statement of church available yet. Do you know what this means? The Apostles' Creed contains the original, authentic, even raw confession of early Christians. How fascinating it is. Apostles' Creed was eventually finalized and accepted as a church statement in the 5th or 6th century. And it was born out of the need to clarify what Christians believe, as a lot of new believers of different cultural religious backgrounds began to join the church. At the beginning of Christianity, when the church was birthed, gradually formed over the first centuries, there was no universal profession of faith available yet, but there were several competing beliefs in different and various interpretations of the Bible, which could be confusing, challenging, even damaging to believers. Heresies, distorted, dangerous beliefs different from Christian orthodoxy arose, posed a real threat to the church as dangerous rivals, confusing Christians with their distorted beliefs and misrepresenting Christianity to the world. Some people believe in early days that our spirit is good while our body is evil. So salvation is the liberation of the soul from the body. This is not Christian belief. Some people believe that Jesus' suffering on the cross was not real because Jesus' body was only a bodily appearance without his full presence. This is not Christian belief either. And some people believe that the God of Old Testament is all about judgment, punishment, condemnation, while the God of New Testament is all about love and grace. So we have two different gods. This is obviously not Christian belief. But it was confusing to early believers. Isn't it similar to our current historical context, though? Our Christian beliefs have been under attack, compromised, confused, infused with a secular understanding and interpretations as the church has been losing our holy impact on the world, failing to baptize the world with the gospel. This is why I believe it's important for us to revisit and clarify what we say we believe so that we may not be swayed or shaken by other noises out there, but stand strong and following the guidance of the Holy Spirit. Ephesians 4:14, we must no longer be children, tossed to and fro and blown up about by every wind of doctrine, by people's trickery, by their craftiness in deceitful scheming. But speaking the truth in love, we must grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ. Did you hear that? Grow up into Christ. As we explore the essential beliefs of Christianity through the Apostles' Creed, like Christian Theology 101, I hope and pray that we will grow and grow up into Jesus Christ, the head of the church, our Lord and Savior. Can I get an amen? Amen. What are the key elements of the Apostles' Creed? It starts with, again, I believe. Each believer is expected to accept and profess this statement of faith as their personal declaration of who they are before the Lord and before a watching world. As we all individually accept and profess this shared belief, this belief becomes our collective statement of faith, that's called the creed. We believe. And the structure, the format of the Apostles' Creed all points to the Trinitarian understanding of God. There are three main parts in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, and Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, and in the Holy Spirit. The Trinitarian understanding of God, though deeply mysterious and even ever elusive to our understanding, has been the core belief of our Christian faith from the beginning. Our belief in the triune God has since been the target and cause of misunderstanding and misinterpretation, yet it has proven to be the measuring standard against any distorted, dangerous beliefs out there. We're going to talk more about this next week. And a large part of the Apostles' Creed is devoted to Jesus Christ. This simply indicates the significance of Jesus Christ in God's salvation history and our faith journey. After covering the triune God, the creed moves on to mention the church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and eternal life. So many Christian thinkers have since tried to unpack, elaborate these points as essential doctrines, essential beliefs of Christianity. And over the next 2 months, we're going to try to unpack these important beliefs together. I am excited. I hope you are excited. How relevant is it to us today, though? Long time ago, it was accepted as the church's statement of faith, and a lot of people professed it over the centuries, but how relevant is it really? First, it unites Christians of all traditions. It unifies Christian allies as the universal or ecumenical statement of faith. There are so many ways of approaching God through different ways of worship and traditions and denominational structures, right? But this statement, wow, unites us as Christians, unifies our forces. One of the slogans of the United Methodist Church is this: in essentials, unity; in non-essentials, liberty; and in all things, charity. What it means is that regardless of our different backgrounds or cultural differences, we are united in our essential beliefs as clearly declared and stated in the Apostles' Creed. And while we are free, at liberty to choose however we would want to express our beliefs in different contexts, and we are called to embrace each other, our differences, diversity, with charity, with love. We are Christians after all, as long as we share the core common beliefs together. Shall we check it out? Ephesians 4, 1 through 6. The Apostle Paul was speaking to the Christians. Ephesians 4, 1. I therefore, the prisoner in the Lord, beg you to lead a life worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility, gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, making every effort to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to the one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all, through all, and in all. Wow, the emphasis on the unity of the church, the Christians, is unmistakable in this passage, isn't it? Second, Apostles' Creed is a critical tool to measure and discern what is wrong or right in our theological and our faith journey. What is acceptable or dangerous for Christians? What is heresy or orthodoxy? If you ever suspect a religious community or organization and want to see how that group is congruent with the essential beliefs of Christian faith, simply check that group out through the lens of the Apostles' Creed. It will reveal a lot about their nature. Third, Apostles' Creed is a powerful declaration of our faith. And we say, I believe in the crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus Christ. We are boldly declaring that we are no longer under the dark dominion of sin and death, but under the forgiving grace of God, thanks to the precious blood of Jesus Christ. We're declaring that we are now participating and celebrating ultimate victory over the spiritual forces of evil in the name of Jesus Christ, who came to the world, lived among us, took our sins in his own body, died on the cross in our stead on our behalf for the forgiveness of our sins once for all. The third day he rose from the dead, broke off the chains of sin and death, has conquered the world, is with us always to the end of the age. Hallelujah! I am fired up! So when you find yourself anxious and worried or even terrified, what do you need to do? Remember to recite the Apostles' Creed, remembering that so many Christians have professed this faith as a spiritual weapon over the centuries. One of my dear brothers in Christ, when they told me that when he needs the comfort, the peace, or strength from the Lord, he recites the Apostles' Creed. How powerful it is. I want you to begin to practice it so that you may experience its benefits. Many congregations across the world actually recite the Apostles' Creed every Sunday during their Sunday service. So I hope that by the time when this sermon series is over, we all will be familiar with the Apostles' Creed and have a clear understanding of what we say we believe, so that we may confidently testify to the power of God in our words and our thoughts and our deeds. All God's people said, Amen. Every first Sunday of each month, we gather around the Lord's table and receive the blessing from the Lord. Shall we prepare our hearts in prayer? Online worshipers, please prepare a bread or cracker and juice in the cup so that I may bless them in the name of the Lord. Let us pray. Lord, we give thanks to you for this holy opportunity to participate in Holy Communion, sitting around the Lord's table in spirit and prayer. We are ever thankful for the precious blood of Jesus Christ shed on the cross for us, for the redemption of our souls. Will you bless the bread and the juice we prepare at home and at the church, so that as we participate in Holy Communion, we may experience holy union with you and celebrate joyful fellowship with each other as one family of faith, being united under the Lordship, the authority of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. On the night in which Jesus Christ gave himself up for us, he took the bread and gave thanks to God, our Heavenly Father, and broke the bread and gave it to his disciples and said, Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. When the supper was over, he took the cup and gave thanks to God, our Heavenly Father, and gave it to his disciples and said, Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Now it's time for you to take and eat the bread or the cracker. This is the body of Christ given for you. It's time to drink from the cup. This is the blood of Christ shed for you. Jesus loves you so much. Thank you so much for being with us as we honor and worship the Lord together. Our journey with the Apostles' Creed will continue on next week. Hope to see you again. Have a great week in the Lord. Go now in peace to love and serve the Lord. Recite the Apostles' Creed in your daily life, and you will experience the power of God, the amazing grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the steadfast love of God the Father, the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. Oh, is that it?
song.